Welcome back with the fifth panel today in our Celebrating Dissent weekend. My name is Juri Albrecht, I'm director of the Bali, and I'm briefly introducing the moderator of this evening. You've just seen a video, an art video by Atosha Farahmand. I hope I pronounce her name right. She will be performing in a panel later on tonight. We're having a panel, Women Against God, but this is a panel on separation of religion and state, and moderated by, like I said, Bertjan Gunel, and it's a great pleasure actually to announce her here tonight. Among many other things, she is a partner of NGL, that's an international executive search company, and she is a public speaker, on leadership, and a well-known advocate of diversity in the boardroom in Holland, which is really necessary in Holland, I would say. And she writes articles and books on that, and she wrote a book, We hebben al een vrouw, which would translate maybe in We already have a woman. But it's a special great honor to welcome her here because she is a member of our board. We are a foundation, and the Bali is a foundation, and Bertjan is on our board, which we're very happy with, and she's looking oversight, doing oversight on the directors, especially on the financial part. So thank you very much for agreeing to chair this meeting, Bertjan, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Juri. Thank you for your nice words, and welcome all for this festival celebrating dissent, and in particular to this program, Separation of Religion and State. We have a very interesting program with very distinctive speakers. To be honest, I had some difficulty because for me, each and every one of those speakers deserve at least 1 hour time to share their views and their experiences with us, and we're going to have to deal with 1 hour with all of them. I'm trying to do it not quick and dirty, but I need to take care of the time, so please bear with me. These programs are live streamed for your information and can be watched until the eternity on the website of the Bali. And there will be room for you to forward your questions at the end of the program. And when you have a question, I will appreciate when you end it with a question mark. That was the joke of the evening. That's the joke, that's it. Now we're going serious about this program. We will talk about secularism. Which is often seen as a Western concept nowadays. But the demand for separation between religion, state, and law is particularly important for those living in the theocracies and religious states. But secularism is not new. It has been important for state affairs for some more time already. The departure from reliance on religious faith and going to reason and science marks actually beginning of the secularization of education and society in history. As a philosophy, it seeks to interpret life on principles taken solely from own experience, thought values, and reasoned morale without recourse to religion. We will today discuss how secularism is a minimum precondition for the rights of women, LGBT+, ex-Muslims, and minorities, and also I would like to add children, and talk about universal human rights. And we will do this with Elzbieta Podlesna, Homa Arjomand, and Annie Laurie Gaylor, and Sadia Hamid. But I will first like to start with Afsana Lachaux. Afsana, if you could join me, please.
Thank you.
Just a brief introduction. Afsana Lachaux has been fighting for many years to bring her son Louis home. Louis lives in Dubai, where Sharia law prevents Afsana from visiting and gaining custody of her son. Afsana's long-running legal campaign for justice continues both in the UK and in France, and she's also currently writing a book on honor killings. Afsana, welcome. I'm very honored to have you here. How old is your son?
He is 9 years old now.
And how long haven't you, you haven't seen your son?
It's a very difficult answer. I'm actually currently in a court case at the moment. Mm-hmm. But he was taken by an order of the Dubai court in 2013. And up until 2017, I didn't have any contact with him. So I have some minimal contact with him at the moment.
Okay.
But he still remains in Dubai.
So you need to go to Dubai every time to be able to see your son?
If I want to, have a proper relationship with him, I would have to go back to Dubai.
Mm. Could you give us some latest updates in the case? Because it's a bit complicated. You have to do with Dubai, where there's Sharia law. We'll come back to that. But also UK and France is involved. How come?
Okay. It's thanks, everyone, for coming. It's wonderful to be here, I should say. It's a very complicated case, so bear with me. So I've been in an 8-year multi-jurisdictional legal battle in three countries, Dubai, France, and the UK. And what that legal case is about, it's a case precedent, it's a very unique case. There is none other like it, certainly in the world, I think. And basically, so what happened to me was 5 years ago, I was facing a prison sentence in Dubai court. They accused me of kidnapping my own child. They'd already taken my child away before that, but I was going to be imprisoned. This was in 2014, because the Islamic court had said that I had behaved very badly as a mother, and I had not obeyed court orders, and they wanted to imprison me. So I was actually being held at that time, and was actually convicted of kidnapping, but I, because of a public campaign, I didn't have to spend time in jail. But what happened before that was I had a child in Dubai, Louis, with a French Catholic man. It's very important for these details. And our relationship had broken down. And I wanted to come back to England with my child for protection and safety. Mm. But he used the law and the state machinery that ended up with me being arrested, detained in prison cells with my baby. I was thrown into a UAE prison cell. I was assaulted by UAE prison guards just because he could go running to the court and use the court machinery and the police against me. So I had faced effectively state harassment in a country that wasn't my own. And then what I didn't know was that he had, this French Catholic man had gone to the Sharia court and had divorced me under Islamic law. And the court had ordered the removal of my son because they said that I was an apostate. I come from a Muslim family, I'm of Muslim heritage. And they said I had neglected my son. They'd used things like I'd caused eczema, he had eczema. So that was a ground for neglect. So all these things were happening.
Where was that exactly now?
That was in Dubai.
Dubai.
So everything that took place was in Dubai. So there were all these things that are happening to me, state harassment. I was arrested and detained several times. Then, you know, he had gone to the Islamic court. So all these things were happening. I was in hiding at the time, because if you're arrested several times by the police and you're assaulted in a country that has no respect for human rights and no respect for women, you have no protection. So I ended up in this trial where I was convicted.
So do I understand correctly? A French Catholic goes to Sharia court to divorce you?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay.
But I know.
I just need to take a moment.
Yes.
And what happened then? Just short story. Why is France now, France and UK included in this?
Okay, so that's...
And what's the situation there?
So that's the background. So once my son was taken from me, I mean, obviously I'm going to rush... It was a very, as you can imagine, a very traumatic time for me. Very difficult period in my life. And... you know, I think people read about the UAE now, you have no lawyer, you have no freedom, I was cut off from my family. It was only because of a very, very public campaign in the UK. I have some older children and family in the UK. They did a campaign, and it's because of The Guardian, the BBC, CNN, because of what happened, and I guess because I'm British, and I was going to prison for a long time, mm-hmm. The whole... publicity meant that actually, although I'd been convicted of kidnapping, they didn't imprison me because obviously that would look very bad for them. And I managed to get back to the UK. So to cut a long story short, when I came back to Europe, I couldn't come back with my son. I wasn't allowed to. I wasn't allowed to see him. So they had, the Islamic court had basically taken away all my parental rights. And said, you know, obviously I'm an unfit mother, so I therefore don't have no rights to my son. And so I came back to England, and I started with the help of a lot of people and a lot of support, people like yourselves, actually. I started a campaign to fight for justice, to fight to be reunited. I managed to find some fantastic lawyers and support, particularly from the feminist movement, women of colour and minorities. And I've been fighting a case in France and in the UK for them not to recognise, because I'm a British citizen. So the fact that I'm a British citizen, I actually married my husband in London. So I'm married in London. My son is British. He has dual nationality. Yet I was divorced in an Islamic court. And what I wanted the British courts to do, actually, is to say, oh, we do respect human rights. We will not endorse a Sharia Islamic judgment because it's so fundamentally against children's rights, against women's rights, against everything we believed in. Instead, the English court in, I think it's 2017, I was in court. It was a horrible experience, listening to a judge who said that that I was demonizing UAE Sharia law. The Sharia law is, there's the same as British law. I'm quoting him. Yeah, he said it's the same as, so this is quotes from the judgment. And there's nothing wrong. And actually, had I been in England, I would have been arrested and he would have had me arrested because of my behavior. So I had to go through that, which you can imagine, again, you know, was horrendous. But in France, I had a parallel case. It went all the way up to the French Supreme Court. And the good news is exactly the same details. Mm-hmm. The French Supreme Court, just this year, said, no, we will not endorse Islamic Sharia law because in France, men and women are equal before the law. So, so in summary, this is if you can get your, I'm going to give you a mind something, and I'm not going to say the word, but... So, Bertrand, I'm in a very unusual situation then. So in France, I'm technically not divorced because they refuse to recognize the Islamic Sharia divorce, but Britain ignored the French judgment. Yeah, so the British courts have said, nope, we don't accept. The French can do what they like. That is their country, their public policy. So it's all about public policy. But in Britain, I'm divorced. So so I have different status in every country, but the end effect is I still don't have access to my son in the way that a parent would have. So my fight in the British courts now, I'm lodging an appeal. This is my 8th year, so next year will be my 9th year in the Supreme Court in Britain. And I'm hoping to ask the British Supreme Court and the judges to say, look, France has said this is fundamentally violates public policy, women's equality, and human rights as well. And I want to take that argument, or my legal team will take that argument, to the British Supreme Court to basically, for me to have some rights and justice.
A mind-blowing story. Unbelievable. And at the end, you end up with not having, being able to see your son the way a mother should. Well, you don't have a glass ball, but what do you think or hope will happen now?
It's very hard when you're fighting, especially as I've been, you know, the law in 3 different countries. Then there's all the emotional things as well. And then I've been campaigning. I can't go back to Dubai. You know, it's like Saudi. If you're a woman, particularly, I will be arrested. And in fact, I've been told, like most people, when you're banned from a country, not to go, as many of us probably here. I don't know. I think for me, it's very important. I think the theme we're talking here is that we need to stand up to the laws, particularly in countries where we feel they're Western liberal democracies, because if they continue to recognize these regimes, these, I think, evil regimes, actually, and rogue states, then they don't have any right to talk about human rights. They don't have any rights to talk about women's equality. And there's also another aspect, I think we were speaking earlier about children's rights. I mean, for very much, I am a women's rights campaigner. You know, I believe in all those principles of equality. But also, what about my son's rights? My son's right to the right to a family life, which all the courts have ignored. I mean, forget the Dubai court. I mean, clearly they don't care. But I still believe when it comes to matters in terms of universal human rights and how we conduct ourselves with countries, Britain is in this awful situation now, which I'll mention it, Brexit. We are going to sell ourselves to the highest bidder. So we are going to sell our rights away, actually, if we're not careful, to countries who will torture, who are torturing, who are killing, who do not believe in any rights. And that's a really dangerous path. One day, I think, maybe after all my struggles, I'll end up having, hopefully, a relationship with my son. But I think it's, for me, it's too far in the distance. I'm so locked in and so consumed that I can't think about it right now. Yeah. So.
Well, being a mother myself, I can't even start imagining what you have been going through. Thank you for sharing your story, and we'll come back to you again later. Thank you. We will, of course, continue the conversation. And now I would like to invite Homa Arjomand and Sadia Hamid to join me, please. Just a brief introduction. Homa Arjomand is an Iranian-born political activist who runs the international campaign against Sharia court in Canada. She received the 2005 Toronto Humanist of the Year Award and was recognized as Women of the Year by Gazette de Femme, amongst others. She's the spokesperson of women's liberation in Canada and founder of the Cultural Bridges. Welcome, Homa.
Thanks so much.
And we have Sadia Hamid, is spokesperson of the Council of Ex-Muslims of Britain. She's also a human rights activist and consultant on the subjects of honor-based violence, forced marriage, and female genital mutilation. Based in Gloucestershire, I need to work on that, working in the sexual violence field with a focus on the black minority ethnic women. I'm so glad that you're here.
Thank you.
Just to be clear about the Sharia law, we heard the story about what the Sharia law. There's no separation between religion and state. What does that mean, Saida?
I mean, if I'm honest, I don't think I've ever seen secularism in my life, really. Like, Britain isn't a secular state. We can't pretend that it's a secular state. We have 26 bishops mm-hmm. in the House of Lords. I mean, the House of Lords in itself is an undemocratic joke. But I haven't seen secularism in practice in my life.
What does that mean, the secularism for you? What
for me personally, yes. So I've been told that my version of secularism is very, very extreme because I wouldn't like any religion in the public sphere at all. To me, even the hijab is a form of proselytizing. When I was a believer, I was told that Muslim women have to dress in a way that separates them apart from their non-religious, non-Muslim counterparts. So I find even hijab a form of proselytizing, and I don't want it in the public space. I don't like any religious symbols in the public space. So for me, that means just getting it out.
Why do you find it so important?
Secularism, because
yes.
it levels the playing field. So when you have a country that chooses a religion as it, you know, to be part of the state, it not only chooses a religion, it has to choose a sect within that faith. So for instance, in the UK, we have the Church of England. In Pakistan, we have Sunni Islam. In Saudi, we have Wahhabi Islam. In Iran, we have Shia Islam. So what that means then is that other sects, as well as other faiths, feel inferior. Now, in Pakistan, for instance, if you're an Ahmadi, the state says that you can't even call yourself a Muslim. You are executed for calling yourself a Muslim. In the UK, it manifests differently because what we have is one religious group that's prioritized and one religious sect that's prioritized. But then what that means is that other religious groups can then go and lobby and say, well, they've got priority. We want a bit of that pie too. But then irreligious people are the ones that lose out. They're the ones that are the worst off.
If we want to concentrate on the women's rights and LGBT plus rights and children's rights, why is it bad for women and LGBT plus?
I mean, if you look at what Saudi just recently did, Saudi raised the status of women from an object to an animal. We're not human. So that I don't know of any religion. So am I making a funny noise with this? Okay, sorry. Religion doesn't give women rights. I don't know of any religion that gives women the same equality that a man has. So if you're just a non-human. So if you are a feminist or you care about equality, I don't think religion even comes into the conversation in that matter.
And Homa, you founded the international campaign against Sharia court in Canada. When was that, and what was your purpose?
First of all, thank you for organizing. Thanks, Diwali, to organize this, and Mayam Namazdi, thank you for everything you do. Plus, thank you all for attending this. It's very important for our pool of secularism, I call it, against pool of reactionary backward traditions and religion, no matter which religion we're talking about. But the reality is, we had faith-based arbitration
Nobody knew about it in Canada. In 1981, the law decided to have faith-based arbitration. Means that anyone coming from any faith, instead of going through family law, family court, they could go to their own faith, whatever it is, and get the divorce and custodies and property division and whatever. But none of the real Canadians who were born and raised and 10 generation or 5 generation before, they were not aware of this. And I wasn't aware of this. So by coincidence, one of my clients who was coming from Pakistan, she was fighting for her rights to get the custody issue. But suddenly, out of nowhere, the husband took her to Sharia court, which we didn't even know is allowed. And then that's it. She got divorced within one day. So to me, it's a political agenda. It's not individual religions such as Christianity who is divorcing a woman at the church. It was a political state, and they announced it as a Sharia court, and they mentioned it. If you are Muslim, you have to get divorced through Sharia court, or else you face consequences, which is that you're apostate. So what happened in my case, we ran international campaign against it, and thanks to women's right internationally, specifically women's right in France, I only needed, as a coordinator, I only needed 100 spokesperson. Thousands of people put their hands out, and they became a spokesperson of women's rights against any faith-based arbitration. And this is the reality. So we ran two international rallies in front of Canadian embassy. And I tell you something, in Iran, running by Islamic State, over 150 people, women, they went to Canadian embassy at that time was open, and they said, no Sharia court in Canada. In here, we had activists such as Mayam Namazi, we had Azar Majidi, we had Azam Kamguyan. We are talking about all activists of women's rights who really understood the separation of state and religion. They became the spokesperson of this campaign, and they managed to go to Canadian embassy here, and they went harshly against Sharia court in Canada. In Germany, we had Mina Hadi, we had so many other activists. In France, I can't even name them, over 100 people. So the point is, we managed to amend the law. And for amendment, even though they promised me, I said the campaign is running because it's a political agenda, and we are political too. We want no more faith-based arbitration anywhere. So we're running the campaign even though we are successful, and we managed to push back Sharia court in Canada and all other faith-based arbitration. We said one blanket for all, every family issue should go through secular court system. And to be honest, only through secular court system, through secular government, you can guarantee the women's right and children's right. And right now, we're running international campaign for one secular school system for all. And please join us. Can I say one more thing?
Go ahead, please.
You know, women in Iran are the, I am very proud of them. Women in Iran now ahead of us sitting here, they're running campaign for laicity. They want laicity, not even separation of religion from a state. They want atheism. They want, you know, they want actually religion to become a private matter of individuals. Please support them too and join our campaign.
It's I needed to breathe, I'm sorry. Tell me about the women's rights in Sharia law.
You know, to be honest, we have a good example sitting here right in front of us. Please give her a hand. This is not a fight of Farzana at all. It's a fight for all of women's rights internationally. It is the fight of all human rights internationally. It's not just against Sharia, against all religion. Religion belongs to 7th century and we are in 21st century, for God's sake. So we need to get rid of it. But I use for God's sake because everybody thinks, oh, the law, the homosexual. But the reality is, we need the law to protect women's rights. And we need international law. When I talk about UN, United Nations, they say, oh, you are a supporter of United Nations. I'm not a supporter of United Nations. But we need a governed body. So that we can go there and say, bring the universality rights for women and children and enforce it. All these countries who are member of these United Nations, so-called United Nations, they're not united at all, but in reality, all these countries, they need to adopt this law that they are putting in place. And that's why this fight, to me, needs to go to United Nations and make progress there, amend there. Otherwise, we are nowhere. We're just going out and have balloons and cry for all the beloved ones we lost. We need to make amendments. Legally, we have to make sure the laws are staying secular and is united for all the residents or global citizens across the country. So her divorce would be exactly the same type of divorce you would have it in Canada or in England or in France, and also no child would be forbidden not to see her mother or her father. They don't have to live together, but still she could be the best mother ever involved in the child's life. So therefore, her campaign is something that I appreciated, and I really, really love to be there. She is the forefront of the fight, and we need to support her 100%.
Thank
so
you.
That's Sharia.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you.
Saria, you would like to add something?
Yeah, and sadly, what we've had is two legal systems running alongside each other in the same country. In Britain, it was only in 1991 that you could legally rape your wife. So finally, we finally managed to abolish that law. Now, when we talk about domestic abuse or sexual violence in the UK, everybody can, in tandem, nod their head. Yes, this is categorically wrong. We shouldn't tolerate it anymore. However, when you bring in the discussion about religion, we'll start circling around the idea of domestic abuse and sexual violence and think it's acceptable. That's very offensive to anybody from a religious community. Religion has no place in law at all. There should be no conversation, however big or small, in the legal system about anything at all. The law needs to be universal, and it's designed to protect us all in the same way. It's very offensive to have any discussion of otherwise.
Is there any discussion in the UK about tolerance for these kinds of activities?
Yes. I used to work in the sexual violence sector, and this service that I worked for was a gold standard service for 12 years. And then we had a woman join the service who was religious, from a Muslim background, a hijab-wearing woman, and they entertained the discussion about rape within a marriage. Women that would never, ever usually entertain that discussion. Why? Because she was Muslim? Because she has melanin in her skin? Why was that conversation even entertained? But that then means that there are going to be women from that community that are going to be hesitant to come to that service because they're going to be fearful that she is going to skirt around that discussion. When I disclosed my own story to somebody in a domestic abuse service that was religious, I told her how I was kept prisoner, I was starved, I was locked up, I was imprisoned. The first thing she said about my abusers was, oh, your poor parents. She didn't turn around and say, that's disgusting, I work for a domestic abuse service. Absolutely not. She sympathised with my abusers. There's a double standard whenever
so
it comes to...
So it's a current practice to relate to the religion. Yeah. Please.
I like to say something else. Now we talk about religion, but we have to be very careful how the government governs. We have to watch it. We have to have more ears and eyes and watch them like a watchdog. We have to all become watchdog. Now they came up with a bill in Canada, and that's Islamophobia bill. Can you believe that? Islamophobia bill means not only you're not allowed to criticize Islam, but also limits so much about freedom of expression. Freedom of speech. So if activists were aware of this motion, by the time you do public education, it's too late. The bill is already passed. And now it's too hard to get this bill amended. So now we have to watch it. I want all of you, because I consider all of you the forefront of fighter for human, universal human rights. So therefore, be all eyes and ears and watch the bills passing. And please, ahead of time, start to write, run a campaign, write it on your Facebook, let other people pick it up and write something about it and run campaign. Another bill is coming. Under the minority rights in England, now they have Sharia court coming in England.
So you've had them for a long time.
Yeah, it's arbitration. Act, I think, 1881 or 1885. So these are the things that we have to watch. It could be no Sharia at all, these minority right bills. It could be Islamophobia bills. It could be any other names, but you have to watch it. Does this bill affect me, my partner, my children, my co-worker, my beloved people who I love the most? So what is it? And always compare it. There is always a reactionary move behind it. And please fight it. Thank you.
Thank you. Beautiful words. Thank you. Thank you very much for this.
Thank you.
We'll come back to you. Now we're going to have a brief description of the situation around Elżbieta Podlesna. Just an introduction. Elżbieta is an outspoken activist and human rights defender from Poland. She has stood up against hate and discrimination for many years and is fighting for a just and equal Poland. She was charged with offending religious beliefs and is currently facing up to 2 years in prison. Still, she refuses to stay silent. Elżbieta, can I invite you to... I was saying statement, but it's a description.
Hello. No, just come to me, yeah. It would be the same. Okay, so at first I've got to say that I'm very happy to be here, and at the same time I'm very sad to be here. because I would never imagine why I was traveling when I was a young woman. When I was traveling abroad, I would never imagine that I would come here in such situation, in such a role. And that Poland, which is my country, would make such a step, I don't know where, because even not forward, because forward it was communism, and now we go to a sort of radical right-wing society, which is governed by fears and prejudices. So I just met a friend of my youth here, living here in the Netherlands, and I just thought to myself, where did it go? How it could happen? Yes. In May, I would like to come back a little bit earlier because I am not so for such a long fighting for human rights. I was mobilized by the last election in which the party called Law and Justice, not having anything in common with Law and Justice, came to power in Poland. And just before that, several months before that, a chief of Polish Episcopal Conference, a chief of the Polish bishops, said some words during the sermon, and I would like to quote it. The state and the church are not two separate institutions which live side by side their own autonomous lives. These two institutions are inseparable, like a body and a soul. The church, if it is authentic, should be the soul of the state. Without spiritual values brought by the church, the state's body begins to die. So that was the declaration which was made before the last election. And it's also important to add, perhaps, that during the same sermon, this archbishop condemned a ratification of the Istanbul Convention on preventing and combating violence against women and against domestic violence, mainly due to a strong obsession, which is in Polish church, obsession of so-called gender ideology and LGBT plus ideology, whatever it is. I was searching for that for many, many months because I am also accused of spreading so-called LGBT ideology, and I didn't find what it is. This last election brought us the soul of very close relation between the soul and the body. I mean the throne and the altar. And it is often said in Poland that it is impossible to win any election without a sort of donation towards the church. And since the freedom of Poland, I mean in 1989, I observed it that all the governments and all the parties used to make a sort of donation, especially from women's rights. That was like in 1993 when they established so-called compromise, which was truthfully speaking, anti-abortion bill. And this compromise was made not between the government or the parliament and women organization, but between parliament, politicians, and the church. So, 4 years ago, so-called Law and Justice won election in Poland, which wouldn't happen, I think, without the huge help of the Catholic Church. What happened later? Because there were a lot of changes in Polish bills, in Polish law, and in Polish everyday life in terms of this very strong alliance. But I would say about the strongest moments, which always happen when we are before a election, when we are in electional year, which is in Poland now. So in April this year, during the Easter time, in a small city near Warsaw, something like 100 kilometers, there was the Easter ceremonies. And during the God's Friday, usually the priest parish builds a sort of a symbolic Christ grave. And this year it was built of cartons, and there were the names of common sins and also crimes painted on them. And amongst such crimes like theft or robbery and such sins, I mean in a common sense like betrayal, we found LGBT. Because, as I told you, that this right-wing party always wins basing on some fears and prejudices, I would say, and also the foreign journalist said this, that the previous winning of the election was because of a sort of strengthening fears of Islamic immigrants towards Poland, which never happened because who'd like to come to the right-wing country? And yes, and make their homes there. And now they were looking for some other scapegoat, and they invented LGBT people or LGBT ideology. So when we saw this, this LGBT in one line with crimes, we thought that it was a sort of call for lynch. Yes, because if somebody is a criminal, you want to catch him and punish him, yes? So we, in a group of three other women, we are LGBT allies, we are not LGBT ourselves, we decided to go there by night. And we placed around the city something which we are accused about now, the posters and stickers with Holy Madonna. But instead of the golden halo, we put the rainbow. Yes, I also think that she looks much nicer now. And, but the next morning, there was a huge rumor about that. And there was a woman who is anti-abortionist and so on and so on. So she said, she made this rumor because it was just before the European Parliament election. And the Minister of Inner Affairs, who is responsible for the police, said that that was the crime. So not the court, but the minister, who is Catholic and who emphasizes very strong that he's Catholic, and you can see him, you know, on TV while ceremonies. He declared that it was a crime, it was a blasphemy, and that this crime will be haunted ex officio. Yeah, so not the private person would come and say, listen, this woman or whatever offended my religious feelings, but it would be the state would run for us, and they did. We were not hiding so much. I went to Brussels, and they knew very well about that, and then I went to Amsterdam, and I came on Sunday at midnight, and at 6 o'clock, the police knocked my door, and they came into my apartment, and they searched it, and they searched my car, and then they changed their mind, and they took me to this city of Płock. I was detained, and I was to be put in jail for 48 hours because this is what they could do without the prosecutor charges. And they detained me for several hours, and I was released because I managed to inform my lawyer, who came and who made a sort of crisis between officers, and they decided to leave me. But what is interesting, the same Minister of Inner Affairs was tweeting all the time that they caught this woman, this criminalist, and so on, and congratulations to the police. So he's better than Trump. And our public policies also Twitterized. And when this interest of the head of the Ministry of Inner Affairs came to the local police, they said, okay, so we'll keep her in jail. Yeah? So we'll bring a sort of present to the minister. And luckily I was released, but as you tell, it is the danger that I could be put in jail for 2 years. I don't know how it will happen because we are very quickly, we are 6 weeks ahead our national election. And I don't know whether my case would be used as the example of who is the winner because the files are not completed yet. Two of my friends who, with whom we made the section together came to the police and just released that they took part in this. And one of them received official charges, the other not yet, because they don't have proofs for her. and we are waiting for the court case. Meanwhile, I sued them. And the local court said that I was half right. It was not necessary to detain me. So I can now ask for the financial compensation, which I will, because I want to support a transfusion organization which is helping trans people in Poland. So it is how it looks like. But just 2 days ago, I have read the letter of the bishops. And the letter asks the police and the state to protect the church against attacks and crimes such as offending religious feelings and to do some actions so that the priests in Poland could serve their mission. So I think that the bishops are quite disappointed and they just knocked the door of the state and I'll just punish them, punish her because of the Rainbow Madonna.
Wow. This is some story. It's
and
obvious.
This is a secular country in the middle of Europe.
It's obvious that secularism is not only an issue in the Muslim world, but it's becoming a universal issue. And that's why I would like to invite any Lori Gaylor to the stand. Please join us. Just a brief introduction, if I may. Annie is co-president of the Freedom From Religion Foundation in the US, originally founded in 1976 with her mother, feminist activist Anne Nicole Gaylor. Gaylor is the author of several books, including Woe to the Women, The Bible Tells Me So, Betrayal of Trust, Clergy Abuse of Children, and she's an editor of Women Without Superstition, No Gods, No Masters, an anthology of historic women free thinkers. Thank you for joining us very much. It's quite a story about Poland, and we were discussing about this preparation, and you said, well, US and Poland situations are kind of similar in a way. Could you tell me about that?
Well, I meant that. Can you hear me?
No.
Okay.
Just keep it close.
All right. Poland is kind of a cautionary tale for the United States in terms of abortion rights, where Poland used to be the beacon starting in the 50s where European women could come and exercise their rights and lost abortion rights so radically in the 1990s, 1994 was it? And in the United States, you may know that the famous decision Roe versus Wade was passed by the Supreme Court in 1973. We're coming up on the 50th anniversary, and legal experts, reproductive rights experts, are predicting that we will lose Roe versus Wade by that 50th anniversary in 2023. I hope they're wrong, but in the United States, you know that we have supposedly a secular government. We have been fighting at the Freedom From Religion Foundation to buttress what we call the constitutional wall of separation between state and church. As the first nation to have a constitution that is godless, that gives sovereignty not to a divinity but to we the people, that says there can be no religious test for public office, all of this is very good, but there's always been a pushback against the secularism in our Constitution. It's taken several centuries for court decisions to establish. We should not have religious ritual and prayer indoctrination in our public state schools, that there should not be very specific kinds of religion and government. So we've been working very hard to forge better law and enforce current law. Well, with Roe versus Wade and other precedent, we are in grave danger because you may be aware that Trump has made two appointments to our 9-member Supreme Court, and the second appointment he made in the fall, Kavanaugh, replaced the person we consider our swing vote on abortion rights and on many other issues. He was Kennedy. Wasn't a very good swing voter, but 4% of the time, but he came through on LGBTQ rights and on abortion rights. and he has been replaced by Kavanaugh, and I'm sure you followed that debacle of a hearing, you know, here's the Me Too movement, and look who we've got on the Supreme Court, two of them. And it has a very chilling effect, and we have seen state after state, I'm sure you followed, states like Alabama have passed almost complete bans on abortion, and this is unconstitutional, and the lower courts are ruling that, but eventually they are planning to get a case up to the U.S. Supreme Court, where we expect that it will turn abortion perhaps back to states' rights. Mm. In the United States, states' rights aren't good. That's what they use to fight civil rights, to promote segregation. States' rights was the big battle cry. So in the United States with abortion rights, this will mean, for example, the state that I live in, abortion would immediately become criminal and doctors would be facing imprisonment for doing abortions, because our state has never removed from our state statutes our criminal abortion law. And so it's very distressing, because the Freedom from Religion Foundation really started because of my mother's early work to overturn criminal abortion laws and contraceptive laws, and we are facing many of the best things that we have in the United States are in jeopardy. And of course, like Sarah, I wouldn't have co-founded a group like this if I wasn't an optimist, but it is a very, very threatening time right now in the United States. We have about 1% who are Muslim, so we're not seeing Sharia courts. In fact, we're seeing a lot of fake news that we're going to have Sharia courts. We have a First Amendment that means you can't have a Sharia court. But what we are seeing, although the Christian nationalists don't get that, but what we are seeing is the rise of Christian nationalism, the rise of white Christian nationalism, with the Trump administration, which is in charge of the Senate, no longer the House, in charge of the White House. And we have a corrupt president who really isn't religious, but he has sold his non-soul to the Christian nationalists. And Mike Pence, our vice president, is a true believer, and he's giving them, throwing them the red meat, everything they want they are getting. And just as an idea of what's going on, Mike Pompeo, who's our Secretary of State, announced a new campaign for unalienable rights. That's a nod to an ungrammatical reference to the Declaration of Independence, in which he said unalienable rights are God-given. And this is the big push. And they have always been hostile to separation of church and state, and they are getting a lot of mileage right now with the Trump administration. The political pendulum can swing back and forth, but unfortunately, our Supreme Court and our federal courts are lifetime appointments. So what we see on the Supreme Court now will affect not just one, but probably two generations. And there's talk of corrective action. We don't have to just have a 9-member Supreme Court, but it would take a huge win by the Democrats and a lot of fortitude to do something about it. So Poland is a cautionary tale. Many young women think this battle is won, and they don't realize in the United States what it was like before abortion was legal. And so we do have something in common with Poland.
Unfortunately.
And what does that all mean for women's rights in general in the U.S.?
Well, of course, the Christian nationalist movement is totally sexist. The Christian Bible is totally sexist. And they want to take away contraceptive rights. They're already doing it. The Trump administration had issued that global gag rule so that any overseas clinics that we give a modicum of public support to cannot talk about abortion. Now in the United States, any clinics that get federal funding to give contraceptive help or STD or cervical cancer screening cannot mention abortion. And so Planned Parenthood, which was one of the major recipients of federal funding and gives health care to 40% of low-income women, has had to withdraw from what we call the Title 10 program because it would be gagged from talking about abortion. And in some states, Planned Parenthood has been the only provider of contraceptive rights, such as in the state of Utah. Yeah. So it's a real public health hazard.
And at the same time, there's a high counter movement, for example, with women political activists going on. And how effective is that movement at this point?
We are looking forward to celebrating the 100th anniversary of women's suffrage, the federal amendment to our Constitution. August 26, 2020 will be the centennial anniversary, and I hope there will be every woman in the United States, every feminist will be showing up in Washington, D.C., and that this will be a political rally as well. Yeah. So, you know, most people support abortion rights in the United States. Mm-hmm. And in fact, most people did not elect Donald Trump. He didn't have the majority rule. Yeah. So, of course, there's a lot of organizing, but the situation with the courts is really the real problem.
I understand. Thank you. Elzbieta, in the interview in the Dutch newspaper Trouw, there was a statement stating of you, stating that laws are being destroyed. What do you mean by that?
This is very similar because in Poland, this party Law and Justice also started from grabbing the Constitutional Tribunal and the Supreme Court. That's the same way, you know. Just to cut the nexus to law, and just to bring their own people to the courts of all level. There are a lot of scandals. We just now watch how it was, on which way it went. But as far as, for example, abortion law is concerned in Poland, this compromise I told before almost does not exist because the Constitutional Tribunal allowed doctors to use so-called formula of consciousness. So they can refuse doing an abortion even if it is legally allowed, because it is in free cases allowed. And they are not obliged even to show to inform which hospital and which doctor could do that. So, in for example, in southern region of Poland, there is no hospital a woman can take an abortion because of medical reasons or because the child would be the effect of rape. There are a lot of laws changed now in Poland. So, for example, the law of public gatherings is so much changed that it's really even difficult to demonstrate that you are so much against. And there is all the time this huge lobby to create the total ban of abortion. And this lobby is very much supported by the Catholic Church and is very influential. And we, as women in Poland, we established so-called women's strike, sort of huge manifestations with black umbrellas, and we managed to stop it twice. Yeah, but I don't know how many times we can bring so many thousands of women to the streets, and how many times we are to demonstrate and how to fight this. And we are so much afraid that this time we'll lose the election, and that law and justice will reign for next 4 years. And I think then we'll become the religious state, perhaps not religious state, but a sort of totalitarian-like one. And it will be with the acceptance of international audience. So. It's so difficult because you can't go to the separate state, yes, and to feel more freedom. But we are still fighting about that. And I would say about the LGBT people, because this action was to support their rights and just to say no segregation, no treating people as enemies in your own country. And but we were always also accused by a sort of democratic side that we provoked the tiger. It means the church, yes, and that they will push harder, and that the reactionists will win the election, and it will be our fault, not the people who brought it. We've got a lot of pride marches in little towns in Poland now, and it's really difficult to stand it now, but we had the march in the southeast of Poland where people were so much manipulated by the bishops and by the church, and they could throw stones at the same time, like telling the name of God. And that's because of we left the education of Polish kids in heads of church. And I think that this is the main reason of our problems right now, that we were not so careful, like you said, watch it, be a watchdog, yes, that we thought it would be a good idea. I think, I say we, thinking about the Poles, so nobody could say 20 years ago, no, don't bring religion to schools, because in secular schools we've got religion, and it's being taught to the kids twice a week, like Mass. And this is not teaching about religion, this is teaching Catholic religion. Yes? So this is teaching what it is, what, who should be blamed and who is a sinner and so on and so on. And now imagine that you are a kid in a small town and you are the only one who doesn't want to go to the religious lesson, yeah? And it is in the middle of the day, yeah? And it is almost impossible to go through that. And the program of religious lesson is not consulted with any council, yeah, because it is left in the hands of the church. So they don't have to discuss it, they don't have to give it to the acceptance, even to the school council. So that's why people now in Poland are scared of Islam, are scared of LGBT, are scared of everything, because it's so easy to bring them up.
So what are you telling us, actually, is that it's not only women's rights or LGBT plus rights, it's about society. It's about the future of the society, of our society.
It's about the future of society, because, for example, the church doesn't want to have sexual education at school. Imagine women without sexual education, completely left alone.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you. Very much, Annie.
Thank you very much, Elzbieta.
I'm going to join you. Just a couple of questions for the whole panel. Can you?
Yep. Yes, thank you. So we have heard all those local, personal, regional stories. That was a very good closure, realizing that this is not a Muslim problem, this is not a Christian problem, this is not a regional problem, that's a problem of the society and also for the future. When we think of human rights, basic human rights, it's mostly considered as Western rights. If we would like to consider human rights as universal rights, what conclusions can we derive from this whole discussion till now?
Homa. I would go that if government does not adopt a right for rights for women, children, humans in general, and also if we don't gain this public education, don't gain the rights to write and think and also run conferences and so on. So it has to be public education as well as the same time as well as law, to be progressive and total separation of any religion, any symbols of religion from a state, then we would never ever gain universal rights at all for human, for children, for women, in a specific children and women. So therefore, we have no options. When we face execution, I had to pick up my 1-year-old kid in November 1989, cross the mountain. When you face execution, you have no choice. You would cross the mountain. Right now, we are in that stage. If you keep quiet, if you don't become a loud speaker at forefront of this poll, I call it the voice of secularism, we be behind. They have money. They have organized gangsters. They have laws for themselves. They've been working for centuries, since 7 centuries, 6 centuries. They have bodies. We have us. So please become the forefront spokesperson, and not only forefront spokesperson, pick up the banner and fight for total separation of religion from a state. In the same time, we have to do public education. And thank you for all you. Being here means public education. Because you take it out, you talk to others, and hopefully you run conferences and panel discussions. That's the only way.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I, sorry, just add to that?
Sure.
So what you were just saying at the end there, what we've seen in the UK, so every child has a right to education about their body, about their well-being, about sex, consent, and healthy relationships. And as women's rights activists in the UK, we've wanted that for decades. Finally, we reached a position, excuse me, sorry, I've got a bad throat, so I might end up coughing in the mic. Finally, we ended up in a position where, as of this year, it was supposed to be made mandatory to have relationship and sex education in schools. Now, that has been pushed back to 2020, so that's, as of next year, it's going to be mandatory, because there was so much protesting from religious groups, and it was every single religious fundamentalist. They used the excuse of LGBT rights and the education about LGBT. Actually, they don't want any education about relationships, sex, education. But because there is this dancing around whether LGBT is permissible in religious communities, that opened up the space as a starting point to allow protests around this issue. And then every single religious fundamentalist has been involved in these protests to some degree. First, they started about the education about LGBT rights, but this is about the whole project. They don't want any education about sex, about relationships, about consent, about what is a healthy or an unhealthy relationship. They want to stop it all, and they use the excuse of that one area that there's a little bit of muddiness around, and it's really dangerous for our kids.
Thank you for that. Let's go to another dimension. Where in the middle of all this, all those countries violating many rights of people, human, women, children. How ethical is it to jointly work with these countries? Like the World Cup in Qatar or the Guggenheim in Abu Dhabi. What does that mean to you?
Well, for example, I was going to say the United States' coziness with Saudi Arabia, for example, totally unacceptable. I mean, of course, it sends a message that it was fine how you've been treating women and how you imprison people and how you start the war in Yemen and we help it. It's unconscionable.
I actually wrote an article about this quite a few months back, but about soft power. So these countries, actually, it's nothing new. They've been using soft power for, you know, years, and sinking money into real estate, into our schools across Europe. And actually, although we like to pride ourselves in Europe, we do have double standards, because we go back to these rogue regimes, whether they're in, you know, the Orbans or, you know, whoever, the Trumps. People focus on America, but actually the problem is actually much wider than America. And actually Europe is probably one of the biggest culprits of this. So, you know, to give an example, the UAE and Dubai, if you look at your football teams across Europe, it's one of the best examples, your newspaper, your media, you look at, I'm sure like many people, you read a range of journals, The Economist, our British press, for example. I'm not sure about the French press, but the ownership is now, you have to really be forensic to look at who owns the media. It's not just the media, and who is, for example, the football teams. I mean, in Britain, half our football teams are owned by the Middle Eastern countries. The same, if you look at the stock exchange, the companies that are on there. So make no mistake, I mean, this soft power that these countries exert has been around, and it's actually, you know, it's here to stay. So there is the trade. But there is also, let's look at who owns our institutions, who owns even some of the donations that are being given to, we spoke about the United Nations, I know there's tension, I think it's a great institution, but it is seriously flawed. I don't often agree with Trump on virtually anything, but I think on one thing he has done is he's right to raise that. And I think we just look at it a different way. You can't have Saudi on a human rights panel. You can't, you know, you're taking their money on one hand and letting them influence the agenda. The Dubai. When you look at advertising, Dubai, the reason why Dubai gets to, you see it all over the press. Look at airlines, they're sponsoring. So that is how they are influencing. They're like, It's everywhere.
Just to add to it, in Canada, all the leaders of Islamic regime of Iran, in a state of being arrested and put them on public trial, they actually, with 150,000, they have much more, we're talking about billions, but with $150,000 according to law of Canada, they can become a citizen of Canada. And there are areas that you cannot believe it, they make castles there and they're running comfortably their life there because their money is buying various things from highways to the biggest building departments and so on. So yes, we do have that and we need to oppose it. We need to change again law, and the law should not be whoever has money can emigrate and go anywhere else and be safe from persecution, but also we need to watch it. Who are they? So it doesn't matter which country they're escaping. We have to somehow find them, identify them for public, and if it's possible, the law allows us to take them to public court.
And what do you expect from people in the Netherlands or here listening to us? What would their responsibility be?
The same standard for everybody. If you want something for your children, then you should want it for our children too. We don't want different rights, we want equality for all of us. We don't want special rights for one community or different rights for another community. It has to be equality across the board. And what that also means is that we want the education system to be completely secular, to be frightening kids. I mean, I used to be terrified. We used to have a loon. I don't know if that translates across in the Netherlands, a crazy person, every few months that would drop off a pamphlet through our door telling us the signs of Judgment Day that were already here. And as a child, I used to absolutely shit myself. I'm going to die and go to hell because I've never done anything right. My family's going to die and go to hell. That in itself was abusive, but also the education system to allow a certain religion to be prioritized is pretty disgusting. Children's minds are sponges. Allow them to be educated about everything wonderful. Just keep religion out of their life for a little while. Keep religion out of every public service
No doctor should be making a choice about whether he wants to give you contraception. That's not his choice, that's your choice.
Exactly.
Any.
I want to thank Dibali for putting this on, and this kind of thing is a wonderful support mm-hmm. for secularism in besieged parts of the world. Mm-hmm. And I thought the mayor's address was so phenomenal. You're very lucky to have that mayor. And I was glad that she brought up Spinoza, who is kind of a precursor to the Enlightenment. Mm. And the Netherlands has such a history of true religious liberty. Mm. So it's inspiring.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Can I say something to us? You know, whatever in Netherlands gain for anything, whether it's universal children's rights or whether it's any progressive law, whether you want it or not, it would reach to heart of Iran, Pakistan, Afghanistan, because we are strongly believer of universal rights. So fight for total separation in any avenue. In Netherlands, don't worry, we gain it in Canada and Afghanistan. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
May I add one word?
Sure.
Yeah. Poland is a sort of laboratory, and it was a lab for solidarity, and now it's unfortunately the lab for radicalism. And now Poland also needs solidarity in our efforts. So I would say, first of all, just warn people, because what we have in the laboratory will go further. Yeah, it can escape from this lab very quickly and be nearer to you than you expect. Yeah? So please just warn people that we are in danger, and because it is also your danger. And later.
Well, good. Having said that, these last messages, we're going to turn back to the room and see whether you have any questions. Sophie and Jante are here to address them. Yes?
That's true in Germany, in France, in all of Western Europe. The churches are empty, and they're getting emptier and emptier.
Good.
So, yes, I think it's also very good. But is it not so that maybe like believers of Islam do not come for religion, but they come for politics under the veil of religion? Do you believe that this goes for Christianity as well? That there are Christians, let's say, in Poland, who do not give a shit about God, to put it in the extreme, but are busy with the political side under the veil of Christianity. Isn't that true?
Definitely agree that the religious became the sort of tool of getting the power in their hands. So, people are so elastic. And also, this is one thing that you cannot, in terms of Catholic believers, you can't leave the church. You know, that once you are Catholic, you are forever Catholic. So, if you
I would say how it is, because I made this apostasia on my own, but in Poland, Rodo, this, they can still keep my name in their files, and they can report it to the state that as long as I was baptized, they should receive money, even if I'm not the member of the church. So this is a question of power, politics, and also money.
Sure.
Several letters about this. I don't want to be Catholic anymore, and I'm out.
Yes,
me too. Miriam is also out. Well,
and does the state pay for you?
Yes.
To the Catholic Church?
They don't pay for me anymore. I'm out.
No. Yes. In Poland, they pay for me.
The practices differ per country, obviously.
Fortunately, so the next question would be this, to have the same, for example, in European Union, to have the same regulation.
Any other?
I wanted to say, what you're talking about is theopolitics, but in the United States, of course, Trump doesn't care about religion, but he's doing it for political reasons, but the people that he's appeasing certainly do. And these are the climate change deniers, because God gave the planet to Adam to do whatever he wants with. They're people who, about half of the population in the United States rejects evolution. And that we're at the best we were at, it's about 46%. And so there's a lot of dumbing down of science. This has got critical impact. And so we really are dealing with a lot of true believers. They insist that abortion is murder, and women are sinners for having abortion. So I guess it doesn't really matter whether they truly believe or not, because that's the agenda they're pushing.
Mm. Yeah. Can I say something as well? You're talking about, is Christianity used as a political tool too, or not? That's the reality. Well, any religion, when they give rights, they use it. Doesn't matter how they use it, but the most important matter is women as a forefront of victims of this kind of religion. Yes, they are going to use it, and it's a political matter. All religion are organized gangsters. But what do we want? We want individuals to be responsible for their own religion and practice it at home, practice it in the right places. So we want religion to be private matters of individual, but nothing to do or not to come in power. And that's it.
Sorry, can I just...
I think having...
Can I just have to, so fundamentalism is a political game. They are going to try and influence politics. Actually, everyday religious people that aren't fundamentalists, they just want to get on with their lives. They're not interested in politics, really. They just want to, it's like the rest of us, it's a survival game. We're getting on with our everyday lives. But fundamentalists are always going to try and affect politics, always.
Thank you for that. I'm afraid we are out of time at this moment, but I'm sure you will be around to answer other questions. What I would like to emphasize here, that we have here five fabulous women who have been able to free themselves from lots of pressures and very brave enough to come here and to put the word out. Please give them a very, very warm applause. And thank you all for being here. This is the end of this program. As I told you, you can later approach all those fabulous women and have your questions answered. We will have more programs today and tomorrow, and I hope to see you then. But first, let's have a drink, because we're up to it. Thank you very much. Thank you.
like an angel living in hell. I'm like a man that knows the truth with no mouth, so he can't tell. I'm like the cold sewers where the rats grow. I'm like a war zone, I dispatch shells fully loaded with energy. I'm like forever, cause there ain't no end in me. I'm like every secret in a recipe. I am Jeopardy for the Masons. I am impatient. Give me now, I'm not waiting. I am a product of my own actions. I'm a general, salute everyone standing. I'm a captain, all aboard. I am the one that will draw the sword. In the name of the Lord, I am logic. A Gabalanzi, a prophet. I am the talk of the town, I'm the main topic. I'm a force where you don't wanna try and stop it. I'm the truth in the flesh, I'm a promise.
We are so serious. Pump up your fist, march to the beat if you feel me. Yeah, we are so serious, imperious. We demand your attention. We are so serious. Pump up your fist, march to the beat if you feel me. Yeah, we are so serious, imperious. We demand your attention.
Listen, I'm unbreakable, unmistakable. Don't really teach, but if I need to, I will take it all. Born over capable, never gonna race to lose, fam. I am here forever, as long as I can make tracks. State facts, banish all the fake cats, give everything.